You know what my favorite thing to hear is? The music to my ears. Who cares? It's just a cartoon. It's just a TV show. It doesn't matter. Now, while I do agree that it's not worth causing a fuss over the quality of a piece of media, because stuff like that in the grand scheme of things actually doesn't really matter, a story, its message, its overall tone, they do matter a lot, and they don't exist in a vacuum. Art and storytelling is a language. It's a way to communicate values, a sense of truth, and a message that affects people. And as a result, the world around us changes according to the stories that we are told. To say that Steven Universe is just a cartoon when it's affected so many lives, or that Jaws is just a movie when it's affected real-life policy that has taken a chunk out of the world's shark population. This assessment is short-sighted at best. What you put in art has the power to make a change in the real world. And art can even push society forward technologically, which is what we're going to talk about today. Fiction can change the world in so many ways, but technology is the most easy to objectively measure and pinpoint where it's most impactful. An example, when I was a kid, I saw James Bond make a phone call on his wristwatch. And I remember I got a wristwatch from a claw machine or something, and I was asking my parents, how do I make a phone call on this? And I was devastated to learn that that's not how things worked in real life. And of course, some of you might hear that and be like, well, it is possible in real life, because now it is possible. With the Apple Watch, one of the main selling points was that you can make phone calls. You can even make video calls from your wristwatch, just like James Bond did. And that's the thing. Fiction inspired reality. Fiction motivated us and gave us a specific goal to achieve within the world of technology. This is because even if a writer doesn't have the technological know-how to create world-changing inventions, they still have the creativity and the reach to introduce these ideas to people who do have that ability. As a writer, you can introduce the world to ideas that can revolutionize the way that we do things. Because if you work in science and technology, chances are, if you're in your free time, you're consuming these pieces of media. So as a result, art becomes a platform to pitch these ideas to people who know what they're doing, so they can say, you know what, maybe that could work if you did this, or you changed that. Which has happened before. I grew up seeing the world change according to imagination and fiction in so many ways. But again, technology is the most concrete point of reference for how much stories actually matter. Because sometimes we don't think things are possible until we see a reality where that actually plays out, even if that reality is a product of someone else's imagination. Stories help us visualize reality. So now I want to look at a few examples, a few samples from animation that illustrate this ability for fiction to inspire the future of technology. And now, just a quick disclaimer, there's a lot out there. There are a lot of examples out there, even just within the samples that I took, even just contained to the shows that I chose to discuss. So I only covered so much, because if I tried to cover everything, we would end up being here all day. So the goal is to give you an idea of how this concept can actually play out in real life, and some examples of where it could play out in the future and where it already has. So now, we're going to combine art and STEM here. My name is Tom, and welcome to the Runaway Club. Futurama as a show set in the future drives a lot off the changes that society will go through moving forward, with things that are major inconveniences or hurdles to our everyday life being treated as minuscule and easily solved with only a simple device or change in social practice. This alone is an example of how fiction can depict the type of world that we could live in moving forward. Of course, much of Futurama is absurd or hyperbolic with little to no bearing on reality, but there have been moments of realism or even brilliance that could be applied to our own world. After all, the staff of the show was made up of scientists, so they have enough understanding to propose things that could work in real life. One of the prime examples of this is the way that traveling at the speed of light is explained in relation to the Planet Express ship. Because obviously at the time of Futurama's popularity, the idea of traveling at the speed of light was completely unheard of outside of science fiction. But now we're starting to understand a hypothetical way it could be accomplished, and it is not far off from what Professor Farnsworth discussed
discovered with his ship. In the episode A Clone of My Own, Professor Farnsworth created a clone named Qbert to succeed him once he was taken to the near Death Star to live the rest of his days past the age of 160. But the team is like, nah. So they break him out of the near Death Star, losing the engines in the process, leaving only Farnsworth's successor, Qbert, to repair them. As he does, he explains that the engines work not by propelling the ship forward, but by moving time and space around the ship to reach light speed, or 99% of the speed of light to be specific. The thing about this that makes it so interesting, though, is the fact that recently NASA has been studying warp drive technology that functions more or less the same way. The premise is based around the possibility of manipulating dark energy as a means of propulsion through space by moving that space energy around your vehicle to reach a higher relative speed, which in simpler terms is moving the universe around your ship to reach light speed.
Now, obviously, I'm not a scientist, and I can't explain this as well as an astrophysicist can, but this is a prime example of how fiction can inspire reality.
I'm sure that nobody on Futurama's writing team was building warp drive technology in their backyard out of scraps, but what they did do is use their understanding of physics to offer an answer to how we can travel through space more efficiently and reach farther corners of the universe. They used their creativity to establish a what and why, so a more technically minded group of people at NASA could start to work out a how with their expertise and pool of resources.
So that's not a hot take at all, right? We all love Futurama. People praise it as one of the best shows of all time. And it's well documented that the writers knew what they were talking about as far as all the science and stuff went. And that makes it not so hard to believe that they could offer something meaningful to the world of science and technology. But what about you or me? The people who, I assume, haven't had a formal STEM education. The people who don't exactly understand how this stuff works, but we have the creativity to come up with ideas as to what could potentially work. How about a show that doesn't have the same claims to fame, it's not as universally loved, and the main brains behind it are two young creatives, one of which didn't even go to college and is a very polarizing figure.
I know Neo Yokio isn't the most popular show out there, but I honestly managed to really enjoy it. What I have to say about this show has nothing to do with whether or not you enjoyed it, or even if you watched it. Rather, I want to talk about some basic rules about the world and what they reflect.
So obviously we are living in the midst of a climate crisis. If the Earth's temperature continues to rise, the polar ice caps will melt, and as a result, sea levels will rise, causing devastation for coastal cities like, for example, New York City.
A detail not a lot of people realize is Jaden Smith, the voice of Kaz Khan, the main character of Neo Yokio, is actually a climate activist in real life. So it's not surprising that in this futuristic New York City, they made a point to portray a future where the effects of climate change are already here. I know some might say, but this is Neo Yokio, not New York City. But this is where New York City once was, because if it wasn't, you wouldn't have New York landmarks. Where are those landmarks, you might ask? Underwater. There are specific shots where modern landmarks are shown submerged off the coast of Neo Yokio. Neighborhoods are underwater. The New York City that once existed here is now under the ocean. But because of technological advancement and progress in infrastructure, Neo Yokio exists on top of the ruins of old New York. Coincidentally, a theme in both Neo Yokio and Futurama, which shows that technology could have the ability to sustain a livable Earth beyond disaster, which just by portraying this in fiction could very much inspire a new scientific approach to growing problems with our climate. And this environmental choice is a clearly intentional aspect of the show. There are a number of moments that make it clear that Neo Yokio is trying to self-examine and criticize the real world in ways that I'm sure Jaden Smith and creator Ezra Koenig are self-aware of. Being upper-class young people in the modern era, and both being fairly well-known public figures, they're on a different side of the social media age, the age of massive wealth and inequality, and overall society than the rest of us. So while people like to look at Jaden Smith and think this is someone completely disconnected from the rest of us for his social background, watching this show has made me think that's not true. Social status aside, Jaden Smith is dealing with the same existential dread as the rest of us, and he's not naive to what people think of him. Jaden Smith's character Kaz Khan isn't meant to be a relatable or likable guy that only his trust fund peers could relate to. Kaz Khan is a caricature of Jaden's own public persona that you're not supposed to identify with. Kaz's Kaz's vanity, materialism, and shallowness is consistently used to frame Kaz as above whatever joke the text is making. I find it really funny how people will claim that outright bigotry in media is actually satire, but can't tell that accidentally buying an off-black suit for the ball being the end of this kid's world is not the show taking itself seriously. I would question that maybe I'm giving the writing too much credit, but between the portrayal of the sales clerk in Pink Christmas and the shift in Kaz's character to start seeing the negative effects of the bougie celebration of high society on those less fortunate.
The walled city. But don't people live there?
Neo Yokio doesn't concern itself with the safety of its slum denizens.
I'm starting to think Neo Yokio is not the greatest city in the world.
It's pretty clear where the narrative is trying to go and what direction they want to take the character. Honestly, between this and the portrayal of the world managing to survive through a changing climate, I'm really intrigued for what a season 2 would include. I know chances of that happening are low considering the fact that the show didn't do amazing,
but I'd like to think that we would see more examples of technological advancement combating more changes in our climate, for example, innovations like air purification or alternative energy, and maybe explore how that technology isn't as present in areas where people have less money compared to where Kaz and his friends live.
Like the first season, we see this elegant high society, but it seems like the plan for the second season was to flip the coin and start showing the consequences of that elegance on the rest of the world, changing Kaz into a redeemed activist for socioeconomic equality.
Communism forever!
But since we'll probably never get that, I guess I'll just have to dream. But I hope we get to see more because it could be something that makes a difference. Seeing Jaden Smith, someone who is welcome among the company of a lot of our social elite, openly and loudly being a part of such a criticism of wealth and wealth inequality in a story that acknowledges the human influence on our environment has the potential to be a catalyst for some sort of change.
But of course, there is the question of how much social impact Neo Yokio would actually have with a second season. Based on the reception of the first season, it's not unfair to say it wouldn't have a lot of impact. However, there is a show that has had a huge cultural impact on this generation and could pave the way for the future of technology.
I'm gonna need you to take these seeds into the bathroom, and I'm gonna need you to put them way up inside your butthole, Morty.
In my butt?
Put them way up.
You know that meme where people say you gotta have a high IQ to understand Rick and Morty? Well, it's funny, because it's actually true that Rick and Morty does explore some smart subjects, but the thing is they do it in a way that even someone who has no understanding of the subject matter can follow along, which is something that our previous entry Futurama was also able to pull off with flying colors. That's how both shows managed to appeal to such a wide audience with fairly grounded sci-fi themes. They made things like multiverse theory digestible to the general public so they could use those concepts as a basis for comedy.
So yeah, bro, if you have a superiority complex about understanding Rick and Morty, you've exposed yourself as a dumbass for thinking that you have to be super smart to understand Fisher-Price theoretical science. Now that we got that out of the way, let's talk about what Rick and Morty is out here doing.
I remember the first time I watched through Rick and Morty, it really got me thinking about what's out there beyond our world. The fact that it's a show that is grounded on an Earth like our own and explores the outlandish universe beyond us so casually makes you wonder what could really be on the other side of the stars, and what could encountering that mean for us? The fact of the matter is, there's no doubt that there probably is intelligent life out there that will be vastly more intelligent than us, or even just intelligent in different ways. And by coming across those societies and cultures, we can advance as well. This is why Rick got as smart as he was. He broadened his perspective to see what other worlds were doing and how they were innovating. I honestly kind of wish we saw more of that in the show, where Rick is just learning from other people to perfect his own technology. But the real point is, there are so many pieces of technology that Rick creates that seem completely impossible now that in 5 to 10 years might not be that crazy. I mean, so many people already make butterpots, but imagine if we could actually perfect something like the broken leg serum from the first episode. Or maybe even the grappling shoes from the same episode. And I know that these things definitely do sound out there, but they're also things that could inspire somebody educated to stop and say,
oh, maybe I could actually make that work in real life.
But that's only with the world as we know it now. I genuinely believe that we will see advancements in space travel in our lifetime, and once we do, the limitations of what we can do will be broken.
Because you have to think with the fact in mind that there are a lot of young people watching Rick and Morty right now who in 5 to 10 years might be physicists, they might be scientists, they might be doctors, they might be out here inventing stuff and changing the world.
There are going to be inventions in the show that these kids are going to remember once they're in that position to say, maybe we could make this real. Now, maybe we won't be seeing portal guns or interdimensional travel anytime soon, but the C or B tier gadgets, I think, are more than possible. Also, once we start expanding in space, we're definitely going to be seeing some wild drugs, like stuff that'll get you pregnant, make your toenails fall out, or maybe even give you some
So what is my point in all of this? My point is, the future is a scary place. And part of that is because there are so many unknowns. But through fiction, we can start to form an idea of what the future might look like. So that makes the future more exciting than scary. Instead of things changing in ways that we don't understand, we can see our favorite parts of fiction start to come to life. Our fantasies about what the world can be will come true, and the future starts to look like something we can look forward to. When people come up to me and say that nothing that we see on TV, in movies, or in cartoons actually matters, I'm disappointed. I'm disappointed that such an important part of our society is disregarded because so few people think it's actually worth it to think critically about what they consume. Because if every story were to disappear one day, the world would be a much different place. Our ability to move forward and visualize what we can do would be seriously hindered, which is exactly why we need to appreciate the stories that we have and acknowledge the language they gifted us. Because storytelling is a language. Stories can speak to our inner self, our emotions, our hopes, and our dreams. They can give you a sense of direction in how to approach your own journey and find your sense of self, which is exactly why mediums like animation can change the world. My name is Sam, and thank you for joining me on the Runaway Club.